Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. And we there have been some silver linings of COVID-19, and one of those is that we've worked out that it is easy to get together over technology. And so we've got some really exciting events coming forward. Firstly, it's great to kick off with our first CNO symposium and to be able to have Deb Baker to launch us. But watch this space, because Dr. Mickey Goodwin and her team, we're starting to organise a series of virtual grand rounds, and we're applying for CNE, and particularly for our alumni. This might be a good opportunity, and also in the health system, to keep us together. I'm Trish Davidson. I have the honour and privilege of being the Dean of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. And before we start, I just really wanted to give a huge shout out to all of the nurses across the Hopkins system and beyond, and our alumni, and in particular the chief nursing officers, because we know how hard each and every one of you have worked during this COVID-19 crisis. And it's a lot of a burden to think about just not only the well-being of patients and their families, but also really making sure that your teams are well taken care of. And so tonight it's my privilege to welcome Dr. Deborah Baker, who has been recognised as one of the 50 CNOs to know by Baker's Hospital Review. So we can count ourselves very lucky that we know her. Of course, we know our Deb Baker as the Senior Vice President for Nursing for the Johns Hopkins Health System and Vice President of Nursing and Patient Care Services for the Johns Hopkins Hospital. So two really crucial and impressive roles. Since the pandemic, she has been at front and centre of all the activities and also playing a vital role in the incident command team. And as well as that, she's met the challenges of dealing with this unprecedented and unplanned for pandemic. And this has been a huge effort for taking responsibility for the health and welfare, not just of the patients, but the over 12,000 nurses who work across the Hopkins health system. In our school, we are also really proud that she is our Associate Dean for Health Systems Partnerships and Innovation. And she's had a huge impact in this position. And also, I have to say to her and all of the Hopkins nurses on the Zoom tonight, thank you so much for willingly accommodating our nursing students back to clinical. As you can imagine, this is just not such an important issue for them, but also an important issue for the healthcare workforce. And we have been one of the few schools in the country who have been able to do this so quickly. And so today I was on a call with some deans across the country, and we were actually starting to think about, you know, what would the healthcare workforce schemata look like if, you know, we dropped 30% of nursing students and through their inability to do their clinical. So to Deb and her colleagues, we're very grateful. So Deb Baker is truly a Hopkins nurse. She earned her bachelor's, master's and doctoral degrees with us. And we are so delighted that we have such strong connection with such a gifted leader and mentor. So in this time of COVID-19, and for many years, Dr. Baker has been a force for interprofessional collaboration, as well as patient and caregiver safety. And during COVID-19, I have been incredibly proud to tell all of my colleagues how well Johns Hopkins has done in spite of the challenges that the country has faced in the context of COVID-19. So tonight we're going to hear a little bit more from Dr. Baker about what it was like looking down on a pandemic from the helm and also being right in the middle of it. And I'm very much looking forward to the conversation, and it's great to have you with us. So now I'd like to turn the program over to Dr. Mickey Goodwin, who's our Associate Dean of Clinical Practice here at the School of Nursing, and welcome everybody.
Thank you, Dean Davidson. It really is an absolute pleasure to see so many of our clinical colleagues joining us on this Zoom, and we're so grateful. As Dean Davidson said, this does begin a series, so we're excited that we are able to kick off tonight with Dr. Baker. There are some CNOs I see in particular.
Yeah, I'm looking for him.
I think Jennifer Baldwin might be with us from Howard County, Maria Kilzarka from Bayview, Melissa McCogahy, I hope you made it, from Children's. I'm sorry I can't see everyone all at once. Shelley Williams, thank you for joining us, from Kennedy Krieger.
Joanna. I can see Mary Myers from Home Care.
Mary Myers, wonderful. Leanne Sidone from Suburban, and Laura Hendricks Jackson from Sibley. So thank you. And if I've missed anyone, we're just so grateful that you're here, and grateful for all that you do, especially in these difficult times. So without much ado, I think we should get the show started with our very own Deb Baker, and I will put the slides up. So thank you all.
Thank you, Mickey, and thank you for driving the slides. That makes it really great. Thank you for having me. I can't tell you how honored I am to kick off this series. And just in preparing for it, how emotional this is for me, and I think for many of you here tonight. And, you know, looking at all your faces just now made me feel so good to be around so many nurses. I just had a moment where I thought, wow, I hope our patients and families feel that way when we walk into the rooms, regardless of how we're dressed these days. So, you know, there's so much to say about reflections of a CNO during this time. You know, there's so much new information always happening, and just all the cognitive processing and analysis you have to do. And then not to forget the emotional part of it as well. So I just kind of want to set a stage, and I'll go through some slides. I put these slides together just really to prompt me to tell you the stories I think that are important in terms of the reflections, but really like to leave more time for questions, because I think that's really where the conversation is really helpful back and forth, that we learn from each other. And one of the things is, you know, Kevin Sowers pulled us together, his leadership team, a couple weeks ago. And it was right after the Floyd killing that was really awful. And he'd already planned to meet with us about something else, about just how we're doing, a check-in emotionally, right? And we all know on this Zoom call, regardless of where you are in this pandemic, even just for your own personal reasons, that there has been a high level of cortisol, you know, that's circulating in all of us, that usually is only secreted for a short period of time, and then we get a break. This has been consistent, and you know that has an impact, right? But one of the questions he posed to us, and Mary Myers, I think you were on the call, was, you know, what if 2020 was canceled, right? Because, you know, you see all the jokes in social media about somebody give 2020 a Snickers bar, or, you know, what is going on with the year 2020 that we just can't seem to get ahead of things? And we laugh and we joke about it because we have to, but it really has been very, very difficult since January. But you know, what is it about 2020? What is it I'm supposed to know and learn from it? Because there's got to be a karmic and a universal lesson here, because it's been an incredibly heavy lift. And many comparisons of this pandemic to the historic pandemics and how humans have managed and survived. A lot about resilience through the generations. And some of those generations are still alive, right? Still here. So I think it's been, talk about reflections of a CNO, how about reflections of a planet? I think we're all having to reflect on what is important. What do we care about? Who cares? I mean, I really do find myself you know, picking my battles and just thinking at the end of the day, who really cares? You know, we're healthy, we're here, you know, let's move on and do great things. So that's kind of like the big macro picture. But when I think about that, and ever since Kevin had that meeting with us, I think about it every day. Because he's asked us to think a lot about how we're impacted by the pandemic, by the race relations, by the, you know, the sadness and the darkness in humanity. Think about it, how it's impacting you personally and professionally, because that's where the learning is. And that's where the leadership is. And as vulnerable as we can be in discussing those things, it's hard, then the better leaders we will become. So throughout this pandemic, I guess it's been about 4.5 months now, when I think about myself personally, as a nursing leader, I have this circle of kind of states. And I think I wake up every day grateful that, you know, I don't have COVID, because I'm at an age where I'm at an age and a body habitus that if I did, it may not be mild. So I'm thinking, I'm grateful that's not happening. I can still taste and smell and all that's good. I always feel proud. I feel proud. I have to say, I feel proud of my children. I think they've been incredibly resilient. I probably grieve the loss of Lizzie's prom than she did, right? They're incredibly resilient. So I'm proud of them, and I'm so proud of our profession and of our nurses. And our nursing staff and our facilities staff and the community. I'm so proud of how people really have come together. It really is. And I think right now, this in-between time is so hard for us, because it's kind of like that resting period where you know something else is going to happen and that you hope that you're ready for it, and then you can be as dynamic as you were the first time. And usually sequels aren't as good, but you're very proud of everything. And then I'm so humble every day about what this virus throws at us, right? What we learn about antibodies and not having them anymore. You know, everything that's daunting, or just about what the federal government is going to do or not do to help us in this fight, is really hard. And I'm humbled by all the great people and thinkers at Hopkins that we work with and in our surrounding community. But I'm also humbled that we have some of the greatest minds in the world, but we still have a lot of issues. We don't have enough testing kits. You know, we can't, in the wealthiest country in the world, we can't figure out a gown, right? We have to use airbags that are hot and heavy. And because we're worried if we were to stop our manufacturing of whatever it is we were manufacturing, that the government wouldn't subsidize us once the pandemic's over. So we don't innovate. That's hard. Worried is a constant state. That's that cortisol level I referred to. Worried about everybody, right? You know, and we're nurses, we're kind of trained that worrying is a skill. And it is. It's part of high reliability, right? You worry about the worst thing that can happen and you work backwards to figure out how you're going to manage it. And forever vigilant. So this is the steady, unsteady state that I think I've been living in since February, whatever, when our infection control nurse, I'll never forget this, comes to one of our director of nursing meetings, and Joanne, you certainly would appreciate this. And she's at the table and everybody's there from every department. And she says, and she's got a really nice Australian accent, Trish. And she says, so, you know, we're gonna do what we do best during respiratory season. We're going to monitor symptoms of every visitor and every person that's in front of us, like we do during RSV season. So the pediatric directors are shaking their heads going, oh, okay. And the oncology director, but everybody else is like, what? We don't do that. We're not monitoring every visitor that comes on our unit. And we're like, oh no, believe me, we are doing that now. So just a difference that a couple months can make. Next slide. So when I thought about, you know, how do you put your comments into a framework and what's been happening? And I think, you know, you may or may not know that there are always critics of how we manage everything, and you want to be humble again and learn from them. But I have to say, as someone that really has been in the trenches, and I've been in the trenches as well as the CNOs that that I worked besides, and with Joanne Yanu, who's my neighbor, you know, it's really hard to be creative. It's easier to be critical. And it's hard to hear people criticizing how you're managing crises. So sometimes I can take that personally, but you know, most of the time I think about the training that we have and how incredible it really is and how it is almost fireproof to whatever you throw at it. So for instance, in 2010, we had a shooter at Johns Hopkins Hospital, right? It was in my department. I was the incident commander. Joanne Yanu was there with me as usual. And you know, we're trained to, in any kind of crisis, to take care of the patients and then all the people that you call and the chain of command and all that FEMA training. We all get that FEMA training to be incident commanders. There's structures and processes, just like in most of our training, that are reliable, right? Have you ever had a shooting exercise or tabletop or simulation in 2010? No. But when we were evaluated ad nauseum by every regulatory agency after that happened, we passed with flying colors. Our nurses did the right things. The SWAT team came up to the unit and said, everybody out, we're evacuating 30 patients, right? And I'll never forget our informatics nurse standing there in her Talbot's outfit and her purse. And she says, oh no, we have 30 patients. We're not going anywhere. And that was that, right? But so here we are in a pandemic. Same thing, you know, if you have good training, you have good FEMA training in terms of setting up you know, structures and processes that are reliable and have communications baked in, and you work in an organization that cares about high reliability, you're probably going to be okay, because you also have to be humble enough to learn, right? So that worked for us. And I, you know, just to back up for a moment, organizations go through a lot of changes. People are at varying degrees, and it happens often where they're acquired or they're merging or they're, you know, they're dismantling. I feel very grateful, and that's that full circle back to grateful, that we have a CNO council that's very robust, and that's really a new thing for Johns Hopkins. Johns Hopkins has always valued decentralization, competition, you know, compete with each other, get better. And this recent integration is new for us. And I'm just so proud of the CNO Council. I know that I can pick up the phone and call any one of our CNOs and ask, what would you do? What can you do? So that was good. And then fortuitously, over the last 2 years, we've been integrating the Johns Hopkins Hospital, which is like restructuring the IRS. I mean, it's hard, but we've done it where we used to have nursing in departments that were pretty much run by doctors, right? And now we have a department of nursing. And I am so grateful that we made those big structural changes before this pandemic, because we came together very quickly. So the FEMA structure is really important. It's reliable and you know what to expect. And I hope I can speak for the CNO as a part of Johns Hopkins Health System, because it's hard to be part of a big system, that the unified command, the Johns Hopkins Medicine Unified Command, which included our schools too. I know the School of Nursing was on those calls. Was really good. I mean, it really was a place, it was a safe harbor, right? For structure, process, supply chain, communications, IT. And we did so much in a very short amount of time. It is that thing where, it's a necessity. You gotta do it, so you do it quickly and you do it as well as you can. Small examples like getting telemonitoring at Sibley and Suburban where they didn't have it, and we were trying to put that project together. Well, you can do it pretty quickly if you have to. So that was really, really good. So the FEMA structure, the pandemic planning, you know, kudos to the Department of Medicine. You know, had for years and years and years has been planning, what if we have a pandemic? And, you know, we have our bio unit, we have Nisa Ernst, who I believe is here with us tonight, you know, leading that. And I'll never forget, Nisa, when you presented to the managers a couple weeks about a simulation, a regional state simulation that you were leading for Ebola. And instead we gave you a real pandemic and you guys rose to the occasion, right? And the tabletop planning, and I remember getting debriefed on this and thinking, well, of course it's a medical problem, right? It's not a train wreck. So all the patients will be in the medical units and then the other people will just support them when they start to spill over. Well, think about that. We did start that way and then realized we are burdening a very small group of people and we have talent all over the hospital. And not only do we have talent in all of our hospitals, but we had negative pressure rooms all over our hospitals because we had excellent facilities planning. So we were able to work better together after that. So all that planning was really, really helpful though. Some of it we changed, we had to adjust course pretty quickly, but we were glad that we did. And much of that planning, just for nurses, you would appreciate this, is about what do you do with the staffing if you run out of talented staff or trained staff? How do you expand your ratio safely? And to me as a CNO, and I think I share that with the people on the phone, that's what you go to bed with every night. You're worried. You're gonna put somebody in a situation they can't manage, and then they're gonna be very different at the other end of that. They're gonna be stressed and probably less confident. So I really worried about that. Pretty grateful we really didn't have to do that. Next slide. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about communication, and I don't wanna spend any time on these slides. It's like three slides here that talk about the everyday unified command, giving this data update around the CRNP, you know, from the Maryland database, as well as our own hospital system modeling. And then we have some great people in the School of Public Health who are helping us predict, you know, these triggers to whether to stop operating and to start thinking about moving staff. So every day we looked at the number of acute and ICU patients. I think you see this on the news every day now too. Next slide. ICU beds. You know, ICU beds really are kind of a canary in the coal mine, right? When you start using your last ICU bed, you know you better stop doing cases because you're gonna start putting patients in the PACU and you probably need those nurses. But humbly learning also that it's not just ICU beds. There are a lot of acute care beds you need also. And what we're experiencing now in between both surges is we don't have enough beds for the non-COVID medical patients, the ones that hunker down for 4.5 months, didn't come into healthcare facilities and now are so sick. And we're trying to open up units for the non-COVID patients. So it's a newer problem. Next slide. And again, looking at the census across Johns Hopkins Medicine, that's what this is. And if you can see on the farther right in the slides come down, which is really, we're all very happy about. And then the next slide. This one, you know, so something I'm showing this because you think about every day you have a huddle, you have a couple huddles a day, but at the hospital, and I don't want to talk about each hospital because our CNOs are all gonna hopefully give their own stories. But we would look at this in the unified command to say, okay, Johns Hopkins Hospital does have the most ICUs. So what does that look like for the number of positive patients and number of people under investigation? And then below, how many patients are coming from the other hospitals and how overloaded are they? So this is a really great working document and part of our daily communication. Next slide. So when I think about everything that happened in the last 4 months and what were the things that were just that, you know, kind of the table of contents of every day, top of mind, and what did the huddle calls look like? What were the topics that you talked about? And I think we had 3 or 4 calls a day, somewhat different stakeholders. Started the morning, every morning with Dean Rothman, and at the end of the day at 7 o'clock with Lisa Ishii and Gabe Kellen, kind of in charge of the unified command. And in between, all kinds of, all of the emergency managers from all the other affiliates did a really great job at their own command centers and would address these issues. So a lot of innovation and integration happened around staffing. We stood up a staffing office in 24 hours. For the system, it was everybody did their own staffing in the hospitals, but we have reporting in every day about how the staffing was so we could plan for surges. Safety, we developed safety officers, both for transport and for our units. We did training videos. This is amazing. I mean, nursing was behind all of this. Infection control had a small team of 6, and we just, our operating room nurses, when we weren't operating, they became the safety patrol of the hospital and just were amazing because you donned and doffed well in front of an OR nurse. You dare not touch your face. Wellness, so this was a great story, right, of integration. All those things, wellness came together. So they called themselves MESH, and I can't remember what the acronym stands for, but it was all those offices of well-being and the clergy and all the, you know, people that are studying wellness all came together to help provide support for the staff. Community caring, I could get really weepy about this. Hopkins partnered very early on with Maryland, and that was Kevin Sowers. He got out front and said, look, we're not gonna compete with each other. We're gonna have the same visiting hours. We're gonna come together. We're gonna get out there to the 248 nursing homes, and we're gonna preempt contact tracing and isolation and give people PPE and do tests. So that, and then the community is amazing with what they gave us in terms of food and cards. And I think every hospital experienced that. I think some of the images from Suburban, and I hope Leanne's able to tell the story about just how that, the image when you close your eyes was that that community just put their arms around the buildings. Communication, I just showed you data that we shared every day. But we did a lot, again, a lot of videos, a lot of short spurts to people because they couldn't get through all the emails. But if you can imagine every day, I hung out with Lisa Marigakis, who's in charge of infection control, and we slept at the hotel for 2.5 months. And every night she would enter a night from 7 o'clock to 10 o'clock looking through communications to make sure that the guidance was consistent with the CDC. And she would just edit all this communication. It was just exhausting. But we laughed a lot. We just made each other laugh. Training, lots of training. Everybody's training everybody. So not just the training of how to stay safe in these bio units and how to travel with an infected patient, but the upskilling, and that may not even be a word, but training acute care nurses to IMC, to intermediate care, and the intermediate care to critical care was done at every one of our hospitals and done well and continues. And I tell you, as grateful we are to our new grads, and we do need to take our students on rotations because they are our future, we have to train ourselves. And that was another humble moment for me to know that I had a group of nurses that didn't know telemetry and I couldn't redeploy them. They had to be safety officers. And I felt bad for them, right? They went to school, they worked hard, they knew their subspecialty, but they didn't have telemetry training. So that was a commitment. Everyone was getting telemetry trained, and I think they are now. And then dissemination internally and externally, like really trying to help each other, you know, Laura Wood calling from Boston Children's, you know, what are you doing with your command? How can we do this? You know, and then just internally in our system, being able to share best practice and then, you know, going to the other hospitals and making sure that they have the right infection control and everything in place and resources, because not everybody does. And when Joanne called me for Pampers, I mean, we have to help each other. And just continue to share information and concerns. Next slide, please. This is very quickly. This amazes me, you know, century of Johns Hopkins nursing, not staffing with one office, right? Everybody does their own staffing, their own recruitment. We stood it up in a weekend. This was a goal that we had for FY21. Well, it's already set up, which is very exciting. Until this day, we have a staffing office and we are hiring supplemental staffing. The chief nursing officers are staffing now above our budget to open every bed. And then our intra staff is gonna hire about 120, 125 extra nurses for the fall. And we did a lot of training for safety officers, our clinical nurse externs. I love this because, you know, they usually come in, they get a nurse and they do their summer just with that nurse and they learn everything about that nurse. Well, we couldn't afford to do that this time. We said to them, it's gonna be different. And we gave them a chance to opt out. It's gonna be different. You may be a safety officer. You may have to do this or that or the other. You're not gonna have your special love. You're gonna be part of the team. They have been phenomenal. And they stopped me in the hallway and they were like, this is like the best experience. And then our patient safety attendants. So anyway, this is just a slide about in there, we're open from 5 a.m. to 9:30, 7 days a week. And now it's known that you call the United Staffing Office if you have any issues about staffing. So a big, big cultural shift for Hopkins. Next slide, please. So I think one of the things that's really important, it's almost like an accordion, is that during this, we've had to stick to our mission and values. And I think an example of that is having the nursing students on campus. That's part of our mission. It's not just, you know, an economic pipeline issue, it is. But that's our mission. We're here to train and we should continue to do that. We did that, we moved into the new buildings and we should do it during a pandemic. So we have to keep sight of the tripartite mission. That's been very hard with our researchers not being able to go in their labs. I have to say it's easier to staff a unit than to figure out how to get two researchers in a room safely, right? That's been really tough. Leveraging integration, I already talked a lot about that. Quality, you have to still worry about CLABSI. One of my directors of nursing called me the other day and she said, do you think anyone's developed the flu vaccine? It's like, anyone paying attention to that? I'm like, yes, I'm sure that's still happening. And then quality, professional practice, those are the two things that nursing really drives in any hospital, especially in Maryland, where that really matters, that value over volume. So we've had to work really hard to stay on top of things like falls. We've had more falls during this. You know, there's more walls, there's more equipment, you can't hear, it's challenging, and you have to stay focused on this. And then professional practice. I just really didn't want the nurses, because when this happens, nursing is asked to do everything from putting the trays in the room to figuring out the next model of surge, right? We're just relied on for so much. I didn't want the nurses to feel like working stiffs, right? I want them to still continue with their advancements and their professional practice. And that's been challenging in some ways, but for many people, their innovation has really driven them to do that. And then community, it's, you know, this is a silver lining, right? We're so much more involved in our community than we ever were, because we're out there and we're really trying to help those very vulnerable people that can't socially distance. And we've partnered with University of Maryland to open up the convention center, and now is doing a lot of testing. So that's really, really positive. I put big M and big V and little m and little v, because little m and little v are kind of pandemic mission and values, which is another layer, right? We have a different mission during the pandemic. We're at Johns Hopkins Hospital. We really need to make sure there are enough in the supply chain for all of our affiliates, right? That is part of our mission, to make sure that the community is taken care of. So we have to kind of keep our eyes, just like it's two books of business right now. We have COVID and non-COVID, which are different ratios. It's a whole different book of business. It's the same thing with your mission and values. You have to be able to pivot very quickly. Next slide. I already talked about this program. This is our clinical nurse extern program. It's just an example of integrating both missions, right? The little mission and the big mission. We said to the nurse externs, you know, you're getting paid to be here. We want to teach you, but you're going to be part of the COVID crisis as well. And they have been awesome. And I think the next two slides, yeah, we can pass through this. I love this slide, because if you can go back to that slide, because when I talk about the teaching and the training that we've done, this is a group of CRNAs, nurses, a plastic surgeon, and a respiratory therapist. And they're all on this unit that we stood up a new ICU, and all of our hospitals did this, and we'll tell their story. This particular place, the Nelson 5, our MPC, is used to taking care of intermediate care, very sick patients. A lot of MICU patients are bumped out pretty quickly, so they're used to sick. But this was like the United Nations. We had all kinds of physicians, like plastic surgeons, stepping up to be intensivists. And I loved how they write me emails and say, these nurses are amazing. But this is a collection of all of them working together. Our CRNAs were working as ICU nurses, if they've been there more recently. And those that have been away from that for a long time became respiratory therapists. And Andy Benson was such a great partner, getting everybody to work together. So that's what that slide means. Next slide. And this is this morning. I was talking about, you know, trying to get everybody skilled up to this level of competency with this very these very sick patients. This is Nelson 7 that now is almost entirely an IMC. So Department of Medicine has stood up another ICU, and now they have another one of their acute care units almost an IMC. And this morning they celebrated being open for a month. So their acute care nurses trained to take care of sicker patients as a team. And I'm just gonna be more proud of them. They're amazing. Next slide. In our community, you know, this was White Coats for Black Lives. This is one of our emergency department nurses, Michelle Winfield. You might know her. She's always doing amazing things. And so this is just that day. And I think everybody has pictures of that day. Next slide. Is there another slide there, Mickey? And these are our testing tents, and our team that is, you know, in the collection tents. This one actually is over at the Church of Sacred Heart in Highland Town. And they've been doing a lot of testing, which has really been helpful. Trying to get them out of the tents now. We're starting to bring them into building. It's way too hot. So we're working on that. But just a great team of clinical technicians and nurses. Next slide. And this is just the Office of Wellbeing, all the resources you could, you know, tap onto these, and there's all kinds of resources. That's really been a great silver lining coming out of this. And the next slide. And so just, you know, the CNOs, we kind of did a brain dump around lessons that we've learned. I think, you know, so the strengths is that, you know, we were visible, accessible. We all were on our units all the time. We were prepared. We had enough stuff. We have a lot of smart people doing a lot of great modeling to prepare us. Our weakness is that our hospital system policies are not aligned with our university policies. And it was stressful. It was very hard. It was very hard to work with the university through this. That's all I'll say, and really the School of Medicine, because we have those people working next to each other, and to have expectations that some of you have to come in and some of you don't was really, really tough. But we had a great HR department that helped us get through that. The subspecialties, some of them just went home. They were pretty rigid about what their people could and could not do. Whereas we had 60 oncology research nurses at the front door taking temperatures. You know what I mean? So not everybody bagged down, but some people did. Supply chain was good, but it's always going to be, you know, a source of weakness, because we can't get anything from China right now. And workforce, you know, we do not have enough nurses. We had incredible vacancy coming into this pandemic. And the best thing we did was to upskill, because we're in a better place today. But the market, the economy has not affected the market, where people are you know, jumping from agencies into your hospitals. We're still really hurting for staff. And then the opportunity is always integration, training, leveraging expertise, thinking out of the box, and having better predictive analytics. And then the threats, obviously the economy, testing kits, competition. We're competing for the same nurses. The nurses I'm trying to hire as agency nurses are now in Georgia making a lot more money. Really need a vaccine. And I'm really worried about the mental health impact on this, on everybody. Next slide. And there's time for questions, hopefully. Hopefully I didn't go over too much of the time that you wanted me to go. There is a slide after this. It's just a link and we won't look at it tonight. Part of the community giving was a lot of cards, a lot of video messages. And this is my daughter and her classmates got together. And I told her at 3 o'clock, she missed me, I missed her. I said at 3 o'clock every day in the command center, we do 15 minutes of some kind of meditation or exercise or yelling or singing or something. And she said, I'll make you a video. And she did, her and her friends. And it's called When We Take Off Our Masks. So at some point you're able to look at it. It's 15 minutes, or it's long, but at the end, there's a really nice thank you. So I just, this class of 2020, we were pregnant with them during 9/11, and now here they are going to college, maybe, sorta, kinda, and they're an amazing, resilient generation, and I think they are our hope. So happy to answer questions, really want to get questions.
Well, that's just absolutely terrific. So, thank you so much, Deb, for, you know, just inspiring us. And we know you've been through a lot with all the CNOs, but just to hear it firsthand, I think is, you know, gives us all pause. And we have many students on the call as well. So it's lovely to be able to share these sort of stories. So I will take any kind of questions. I do recommend you see that video. It's so inspiring. And we'll be monitoring the chat box if anybody would like that, or you can unmute yourself and just ask a question personally.
Deb, it's Joanne.
Hey, Joanne.
Great presentation. It's good to see you too. So I was wondering, now, you know, I think we're 130 some days into this. We are finding the staff who are designated as the COVID units, where, because they really have isolated themselves from their families, grandparents, and so forth, that they feel so isolated from their loved ones. We're actually starting to rotate to creating other COVID units. Are you hearing similar, where your staff who are primarily dealing with COVID, are they coming to you about feeling isolated with anxiety, depression, things like that?
Yeah, I mean, there's this really great graph that shows us too, this period of disillusionment, right? Like you have a couple months where everyone's rallying and, you know, it's, you know, the world is rallying for you. And now it's kind of this period of disillusionment because you've downsized your bio units. We only have one now. And they almost feel like the pariah again, right? Like they're outside of it. So that's what we've been doing too, is we've been rotating people in and out and giving them options to work other places. We're also trying to give people vacations right now in between these two surges. There was a little talk about, you know, hazard pay. So I do a lot of staff meetings with them on Zoom. And we talk about how everybody had to pitch in. It wasn't really just that unit, because we did start off that way. It was just going to be the medical units, right? We got this great building and they all can go negative. And then we decided that's not okay. You know, we really have to put these patients in several units across the hospital, and we could. That helped. Had we not done that, I think they would be, we'd have a large group of burned out people right now. But I think everyone's feeling kind of funky, kind of tired, you know, just, and then you have to worry about what's next, right? What's going to happen? So, you know, some people, the silver lining has been the cross training, because now they feel like they have more skills, and we have trained significantly during this. So I think that's helped. But I am worried. I'm worried about the post-traumatic stress with this. I really am. And what we're hearing from people is the traditional approaches to this around PTSD. And I think we need something different, because not only do healthcare workers, are they going through this worry about infecting their families, but they're also worried about their families, like their kids not being socialized, you know, not having a regular school experience. And there's guilt attached to that. They're not responsible for the pandemic, but as parents, we all feel responsible for a certain kind of childhood experience, and we can't give that to them. So one of the things we're working on now at JHH, at the HR, is to say, you know, we need to look across the system for HR to say, how are we gonna help our families in the fall? I'm on the on a advisory for opening up a middle school and high school, and we just had that call before, and they did a survey, and I'm telling you, every one of those middle school parents, private school, right? Every single one of those middle school parents wrote in their survey, my kid needs to be in school every day, and I trust you know what to do. In other words, get her out of here, right? So they're stressed and they're feeling isolated. But I think we could help our employees, maybe even have something novel where college students, starving college students, could tutor, you know, for a nominal fee. We could subsidize that, give these parents a break. But yeah, no, I think all frontline workers, grocery store workers, everybody's got to be feeling burdened. Are you paying your nurses anymore to be in that bio unit?
No, we're not.
Good.
We don't say the H word.
I bet you don't. We're all in it together.
Mm-mm. That's right.
So there's some nice comments coming in, thanking you and your amazing team for being such passionate heroes during the pandemic. The nurses are a true role model for our students. Thank you for your leadership and care of your team. And I have a quick question. Obviously the PTSD mental health that you and Joanne have talked about. What other challenges do you anticipate, for example, with nursing imperatives across the health system or really across the nation? Because as you said, CLABSI and everything else continues to happen. It's not like they wait for the pandemic to be over. What are you anticipating down the line?
Well, I think I've mentioned that people are not, you know, we were worried that people wouldn't come back for care. That's not the problem. People are coming back for care now. You do worry for the second surge, they'll hunker down again. It was fascinating to me. My prior life before I went to Hopkins to get all my degrees was I had a degree in psych, and I worked at Shepherd Pratt for a number of years. And I was just intrigued during this pandemic that we didn't have as many psych patients. And I think Jennifer Baldwin is on the line here. And I was round, there you are. I was rounding with you at Howard County. And I think you're spot on, because we were talking about that. You know, why don't we have as many psychiatric patients? And you had said that someone had shared with you, and hope I get this right, Jen, that, you know, psychiatric patients feel like outsiders and pariahs regularly, right? In normal life without pandemic. And so they feel the anxiety of not being like everybody else. And that's why you see them, you know, a high anxiety in your EDs. during the pandemic, we all were up here with anxiety. And maybe there was some commiseration and some comfort in that. Or maybe they just really, really isolated. It could be both things. But it was stunning. The unfortunate thing is now, all of it, right? You're seeing the heart disease that wasn't treated, the cancer that wasn't taken care of. And then you see the domestic violence of people up at, you know, isolated together. So to answer your question, Mickey, I think it's going to take a good 18 months, another 2 years till we really can say what the impact is physically and psychologically for people at the front lines or not. I have to tell you, just like our nurses in the bio units now, that were not now, but before when we were teaming, the bio unit nurses actually felt safer than the ones that weren't in the bio units, because in the bio units, you have universal precautions. We're all head to toe, totally protected. The way I think, Leanne, you said your nurses love those big gowns because nothing's coming in here, right? Those airbags. And we're all doing the same thing, right? Not variation in process. Whereas you go into a unit that's not a bio unit, a patient could be asymptomatic transmitting a virus that you're not really geared up for, you can't see. So I think in some ways, I wonder, those people, what's really hard for me right now, I think, is there's a whole big part of the public that doesn't believe this is really as real as we know it is, right? Someone said to me the other day, if you haven't experienced racism or COVID, you don't really believe that they exist to the extent that they do. And I think that's true. And my daughter has parents of her friends that really don't think that this is as bad as it is. And it's hard because, you know, she's wearing the mask and no one else is wearing it. And that's difficult. Some ways I think, gosh, you know, one of the moms said to me the other night, you know, when that vaccine comes out, are you going to get it? And I said, yep. She goes, well, I'm not getting the first batch of that vaccine. And I said, you know what? I don't have a choice, which is good, right? I'm in healthcare. I'm getting vaccinated. So there is some, like, I guess in the military too, we're going into a battle, but boy, we're going in it together, you know? So I think there's some of that too. There's a lot to study here. I'm hoping the School of Nursing can help us with the PTSD investigation. I'm not crazy about the traditional approaches to studying PTSD. I think we need something novel and a little bit different. So,
Jackie Campbell and the mental health team have made some suggestions that we may be able to help with the trauma-informed care versus traditional psych interventions. And I just want to interject that I see Laura Wood has joined us from Boston. So good to have you, CNO at Children's Hospital. And
thank you, Miffy.
I'm sure you're experiencing very much the same.
Well, you know, not precisely. And I want to pay homage to those who had a completely different volume than those of us in pediatric settings had. We became a regional provider in New England, and many of the Boston hospitals converted their PICUs into adult ICUs, and we became a point of transfer, really working at in a new way, as Deb described, to work as more of a integrated system with folks who in another day and time would have been our competitors, if you use that framework at all, but you know, kind of that traditional way of thinking about it. But we feel very affected by this and in many ways, and continue to be, and everything that has been described, I think, applies. But I will say we had, you know, we never had more than 20 something patients at a time. So that's a very different scale out of our 400 inpatient beds. So small place, really tremendous financial impact. Projections of 250 to 400 million against a 1.1 or 2 billion. Dollar budget. So very significant.
What a hard message, right? Yeah. Work hard, come in here every day. Your family might get sick. And by the way, you have to take some hours off because we don't have enough money to pay you. I mean, really, really hard. I have to give a shout out to our pediatric nurses. I'm glad you brought it up.
They
opened 10 beds for adult patients, and they took care of some of the sickest COVID. Yeah. And they were okay doing the single organ, even though they were really sick. But we had proning teams in the hospital where you, because you had to turn these patients over and prone them in order for them to oxygenate. And they would call it tummy time. And the intensivist really loved that. They said, we like working with the pediatric nurses because it's tummy time, which is a heavy lift prone. But shout out to pediatric nurses are just astounding.
Yeah.
In their holistic approach to care.
And my shout out to Deb, I'll end on this note, just the, I really did reach out to her maybe in April, because we had the challenge of a small single command center, and I was really very concerned about the durability over a period of many months of a small intact team. And so I interviewed some of the people I have the most respect for nationally, and Deb was high on my list. And can you believe, you know, within 24 hours we were connected together. She was that responsive and wanting to be of help. So that's what colleagues do who are of Deb's caliber. It was really a pleasure.
If you're helping me on Friday with the CLABSI problem I have in my... right?
It's a pleasure.
Which I'm really appreciative of.
It's a pleasure. And I'm answering another email from a colleague here online tonight. So it's really a pleasure.
We have to work together. We really do.
The collaboration is so important. And to that point, we have other CNOs on the call who, please feel free to jump in.
Yes.
Be nice to hear from you.
I did see a comment.
Thanks. There's many thanks to you for your leadership, for sharing your experiences. That's the same for all CNOs.
Hi, this is Nancy Glass. Hi. Can I ask a question? Maybe it would, I think Deb can answer, but probably other CNOs. How did the hospital, for example, link with Hopkins Home Care and the nurses are out in the community to have, you know, really top-notch clinical skills as well, providing, and also the work that the transition nurses do? How do you link with those and engage their skills?
Well, they were amazing. And that's, I didn't have time to go into it in my talk, just about all the people that worked in different ways during this. But home care, first and foremost, was really helpful with testing at home for people that we couldn't get in to test. And still, they are our secret weapon for going into the house and testing. A lot of people can't get in a car and go to a testing tent, or are too frail to be able to come into a building, or too afraid. So that was incredibly helpful. And I did bring up something very painful that has been really hard for me, and that is our visitor restrictions. And the way we set it up through the system is that the CNO and the CMO have to review all restrictions. And it's been heartbreaking. I call it responsible for the COVID-19 that I put on. But what's been helpful is partnering with home care and the transition nurses and the social worker to say, you know, because people, you know, families were really nervous about patients being discharged without some good teaching. And we're pretty permissive at Hopkins with the visitor restrictions. We do let people come in and learn how to do trach care and colostomy care, because it's so complex. You can't do it on FaceTime. But even a couple less, people didn't really want to be in the hospital that long, right? They wanted to come on day of discharge, learn and go home. Well, that handoff to home care was really incredibly important. Because they had to reinforce that care. And then transition, so I was talking to you about the patients that stayed home so long with heart disease and other issues. Our transition nurses were really, really important. And there's one nurse that the patient was homeless, and we really wanted the patient to go to a hotel, because the city had set up hotels for homeless patients that were COVID positive. And they had a really bad psychotic disorder related to, I think, schizophrenia. And it was the transition nurse that really was able to say, I'm going to come see you every day, so you really can go there. So yeah, I mean, it's a fearful public to come into the hospital. So those transition nurses and then home care nurses are really, really important. And I'm sure my colleagues across the system have their own stories in their own communities about how they leveraged home care. And you think about pediatrics at home, that really is important, right, for this parent.
And we do have Mary Myers here from home care.
Yeah, Mary, did you want to say anything about home care? Where are you? Are you on your boat?
Yeah, she was on the call. But I think that's an excellent point, because it isn't all in the acute.
It isn't all acute care. And matter of fact, I have to tell you, I'm more worried if we loosen the visitor restrictions. I'm not as worried about the inpatient side. We have enough space in those rooms to have a visitor. I'm worried about ambulatory. There isn't enough physical space in our waiting rooms. I'm looking at NISA for endoscopy. Where are people going to wait? Those areas are much more challenging. And if you're, and I get a request almost every night that the 89-year-old who needs to come and get a colonoscopy and his 87-year-old wife needs to bring him. I'm thinking both of them are vulnerable. You know, I mean, it's just really challenging. Just, you know, the isolation around this has been incredible.
Well,
I hope I answered your question, Nancy.
Yeah, that was great. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
We're closing in on the hour. This has been absolutely amazing. And I think maybe Dean Davidson has a few words.
Oh, she's talking. You have to unmute.
So firstly, thanks so much, Deb, for those words. I too feel very emotional, to be honest.
Very emotional.
Just hearing from, you know, some of our amazing people on the front line. And, you know, one of the great things about Hopkins is that because of the great people and your leadership and the Hopkins system, that our nurses have been safe and our students have been safe. But I know one of my DMP students is here on this call, and I won't call her out because I might violate some HIPAA or thing, but you know, her story of taking care of four ventilated patients in New York is just pretty profound and amazing. And then also we have seen many of our colleagues who have been working in institutions through no fault of their own without great leadership and access to resources who have died. And I think this is a really very unusual time. I'm so glad to have so many students on the call tonight, because you are living an experience that many of us, well, me, I've been a nurse for over 40 years. I would never have dreamt of anything like this ever. And so you're getting to learn from some of the very best across the country about, you know, what can happen. And the really chilling thing for all of us is we know we're really kind of just starting in many ways. So I think without finishing what has been a pretty amazing session on really highlighting the importance of nursing, I also, in particular, really want to thank again our CNOs. Please convey our great gratitude to your nurses on the front line. As Deb says, it's very easy to be sitting back and watching and critiquing, but I know each and every day those people go into work forgoing their own health and they're worried about their families. So I think this has been a great conversation. Thanks so much, Mickey. And I can see Florentina and somewhere Kira organizing all of this. I think we're all going to learn and grow together. And more importantly, we are going to make sure that if this ever happens again, that our systems are going to be much more robust and resilient. And more importantly, that the role that nurses have played in this really unprecedented pandemic is going to be truly recognized. So this has been a great start. You know, this is, again, as when I started, one of the silver linings of a pandemic, you know, trying to get the CNOs together, can I tell you, it's like a year's work. And we've been able to do this overnight, and also to draw in our colleagues, Laura and Joanne, and together we're stronger. And again, thanks so much, Deb, for your leadership. It's pretty amazing, over 12,000 nurses in the Hopkins
system look to you, and I know have felt very cared and supported in this journey. So thanks so much, everybody. Please be safe and well. And together we're going to be stronger, and we're going to get through it. And there's going to be all of these wonderful things in the Hopkins archives that are going to show how nursing has really made a difference. So thanks so much, everybody. Be well.
Trish, can I ask you a question before we hang up?
Yeah.
Can we think about the students that you have that have worked in other systems, maybe doing a presentation if they're comfortable doing it?
Yeah, look, no, I think that's absolutely correct. And also, is Sherry, I don't know if Sherry's on the call. She's one of our amazing students. I can send you the video. So at the midst in, and some of those other stars on that course, including Nancy Glass and Nadia Andrade and Debbie Wilson. So basically, at the just as the pandemic was starting, as you know, we have a WHO collaborating center, and someone said, can you do a course, online course? And so we were trying to make it not another, you know, the world does not need another video on what COVID-19 is. So this is all about health system strengthening. And so we actually followed Sherry, who went to New York, who was from New Jersey, and actually heard Cuomo's call and went back and really worked in a nursing home in some pretty rugged things. I spoke to an alumni just yesterday who's in San Sebastian, who went to New York. So I think that would be a really nice way of telling the stories. And Katie Damaroda, we've been trying to have regular conversations with our alumni. I know Laura has been on some of those calls. We will avoid HIPAA, FERPA, all of those, yeah, and we'll have a conversation.
I think it's part of the healing for everybody if they feel comfortable talking about the stories. I just hired an oncology director from Mount Sinai who has some pretty incredible stories that I think Cinda would say it's that moral kind of hurt that nurses have when they take care of four patients and they go back to take care of the one and two, and they, you know, own the tubing and the everything. That's really hard. It's really hard for them to change their standard of care. And I really think if we have forums where people get it and can listen and learn as part of the healing and learning. And one of our nursing leaders at Hopkins said, you know, that first wave wasn't really as bad as it could have been. And maybe if it was, we wouldn't be in our bubble because we're still a little bit in a bubble. And I'm worried that's going to burst in November. So it would just be great to have some kind of, it's almost like a support group, but really about learning through stories. But thank you so much, everybody.
That's a great idea. And can I just leave you with one line of one of our great PhD students, Nadia Andrade, who's actually, I think, works at Sinai, but is also an MSF nurse who's worked in Chechnya and Sudan and other places. And when I interviewed her for this course, she said, you know, talking about beds, she said, an ICU bed without a nurse is just another place of suffering. Yeah. And I think, boy, that is just speaks to really what we do. And we are great pleasure to collate it. And I see some comments from the students coming in. These are the leadership journeys. You never know what curveball you've got going to come at you from big and small. And the lessons that you learn here will stand you in good stead across your career. So thanks very much, everyone. Deb, we're on to it.
Thanks,
everybody. Bye-bye.
Have a good night, everyone.